Then I asked any question, and then one of the person, that was a great idea, but I don't want my card's location to be known by my wife. And then, so that was a kind of wake up on a privacy issue with a wireless and the mobility type of a thing.
Good local time, everyone, and welcome to this episode of Innovative Minds with Audrey Tang. There's no question that internet is one of the biggest innovations in our lives. And today, we're honored to have one of the pioneers of the internet in Asia with us, Professor Jun Murai from Japanese Keio University. And today, we're honored to have one of the pioneers of the internet with us, the Japanese Keio University professor, Jun Murai, known as the father of the internet in Japan and the internet samurai. Please join me in welcoming Professor Jun Murai.
Okay, yeah, thank you. It's certainly an honor.
Really happy to be connecting with you over the internet. And you've created the Japan University Network in 1984. That's the first ever inter-university network in Japan. There's no doubt that you play a crucial role in the internet development, especially in Japan. However, I heard that you used to be a, and I quote, computer-hating science boy at the very beginning. How does that come to be?
Yeah, that's, you know, when the very first computer in my age, the computer was big and this, you know, it was called a mainframe. Mm-hmm. And everybody lined up and then asking a computer to do the calculation thing, right? And so it looks like very much a computer centric. And I really want the human centric nature by the technology. So technology should support the human being.
Right. So that was so before personal computers.
This is architecture different, and therefore I didn't very much a big fan of computer science itself.
And when was that, if I may ask?
That was when I was between the high school and the college. Yeah.
I see. So before the personal computer becoming really prevalent.
No.
Okay.
That's early 70s.
Right. So, but then you continue to study computer science anyway. And why is that?
Yeah, that's very much, the first operating system with a kind of application-based architecture, which was a Unix operating system.
Okay.
And then the Unix operating system also was the first operating system with a source code to read. So reading, the source code and understanding hardware, and that was the operating system that days was basically from the vendors and to improve the vendor's performance, vendors wanted performance. So it's still the computer centric, but now the Unix operating system from Bell Labs was the application of the human being, and then, it's a hardware was basically hardware independent architecture. That was the first operating system of Unix. So Unix changed my mind to work on a computer science, especially the computer systems and the network.
And which editor are you using on Unix at that time?
Was it
ED or...?
ED, started with ED, of course. And then I'm a very, good friend with Bill Joy, who invented BI.
Okay.
And starting with ED and onto BI. That is for the standard transition of my age.
I know. I can't use a developer environment without remapping the arrow keys to VI, so I'm right there with you. So please tell us more about the inter-university network and why it was such a game-changing innovation at the time.
Right. It maybe two things. One is, as I mentioned, then it's more to the multi-user, and then the computer connected, and then you know, so they need to do the very much of a distributed computing stuff with a network, right? That's one thing. And then you know, also the connecting all the computers means connecting human being. I mean, researchers on top of it. So a user, then you know, the development of the computer network distributed systems turned out to be, this is for us, you know, for the computer scientists. And then you know, to start with, but eventually we are increasing the scope to the other researchers at the universities, like in other areas. So it's for, turned out to be moving toward for everyone rather than for us. So that's a very much an innovative thing.
Right, so it's not just for the researchers innovating for the people, but also with the people, with anyone who wants to participate, a open network.
Exactly. I remember that you know, how many computers are we going to connect? Type of a discussion when we you know, the beginning of the research. Is that the other computer science departments are in the nation or the companies as well? What about the other countries? And then it turned out to be the result in the very early days that we're going to connect all the computers.
Mm-hmm. So wherever they are, you're going to connect them all. That's the promise of the Internet Protocol. And I've been reading some of the earlier pioneers like JCR, Licklider, and so on. It seems like the early pioneers have really this vision of not just connecting all the computers, but also everyone, like literally all human beings on Earth, and maybe in other interplanetary protocols. Do you have similar dreams? What dreams were you seeking to realize with internet working?
Yeah, that's a very much, you know, because of that kind of nature, connecting everybody, connecting all the computers, and then, you know, of course, a planetary view was shared among the other related researchers that time. But then, you know, very much enthusiastic about connecting all the computers on the planet. So we forgot about the border of the nations because it's a purely technology, purely academic community, research community as well. Therefore, it's a beginning of the truly global space where the you know human being ever had, right? So before internet, after internet, then you know the before internet, we didn't have other human being. We didn't have a truly global space before internet, and after internet, we do have a global space to share, right? So this is a very much a game changer concept, and but it was a very much you know kind of developed naturally without considering that you know nobody said that we will need a global space, but it was very naturally developed by the internet.
Right. So on the internet, it's true that we have new neighbors, right, with similar IPv4 blocks. That's one kind of neighbor. .tw, which is Taiwan, is kind of neighbor with .tv, Tuvalu, and so on. So it's basically a different configuration of space and a new kind of neighborhood. Do you think that's because in the early academic setting, the academic publishing is already a global community? And do you think in your typical day in a Keio University, does your academic contributions map to the kind of internet-based, like global without national boundary intuition that you just mentioned?
Yeah, the interesting things about the you know very beginning of internet era, the important relationship with you know the country like Taiwan community and ourselves was. Sharing about the very close cultural background and including the language. So, you know, one of the things I was involved for the very beginning of a Unix standardization at the ISO was very much, you know, character and character set and, you know, language representation.
Yeah, locale LCC type stuff.
Right. Yeah. Most of the computer and the operating system was designed before that action, no internationalization concept for the standardization of operating system before we jointly approached that thing at the ISO POSIX type of activities, as well as the, working with the various vendors, Microsoft and other things about the language. That was a kind of a shared subject with a regional subject, I should say, and have been working. But afterwards, it's getting very important that after the internet is covering and connecting all the universities, and for example, the university class sharing interaction and getting to the real time and then sharing the time zone has been very important. That was recognized. So, than before. So sounds strange that creating the global space in this, but then also closer the cyberspace activities, internet activities, it's getting to closer to our daily life, and then the time zone sharing turned out to be very important. So it's still very important to work together.
Yeah, in the past couple of years, I've become a time zone traveler where I wake up in the Eastern U.S. time zone and then during the day move toward the Indo-Pacific and go to sleep finally on the European time zone and African folks. That's the reality of things. And it seems true that people on similar time zones, like you're 1 hour in the future. So we're literally neighbors. In that case, we form a kind of kinship when it comes to internet standard making and community gathering and so on, simply because we're awake at similar times. Yeah,
that's true.
So I would like to ask, what's your take on the innovation environment nowadays on top of the internet in Japan, according to your own experience? Because as you mentioned, what the early pioneers was about solving the underlying issues, like typing a backslash and not seeing a yen or the other way around. And now all these are resolved. People are moving to the application layer. And how do you see the application layer nowadays?
Well, actually, very much a personal view about my group, the larger wide project research group, was kind of behind in the history was the application area, because we were very much a distributed computing hacker groups. So the operating system network, concentrating on that kind of a basic system layer very much. Therefore, a little bit slow in terms of, the application layer. But other than the World Wide Web Consortium to be hosted at the Keio University and, other one of the hosts, and then web standardization, HTML standardization has been the core layer on top of the TCP/IP and the application layer. So it's still a platform, right? And the standardization to accommodate the people can access, of course, data first, and then the information first, and then on to the application development platform turned out to be right web. And so web layer is next. Important layer to be working together, especially getting closer to application is touching on the culture, touching on the language and the way for the direction of the language, especially to be standardized as a part of HTML5, what has been the kind of also the joint work between the Taiwan and the Japan.
Yeah, I remember working on not just displaying the font and date and so on correctly, but actually carrying the information on payments, on identities and things like that. So indeed, the web has been growing very vibrantly on top of the internet working layers you just talked about. It's been around 30 years since I first connected to the internet with a dial-up modem. I think it was 600 baud or 1200 about or something. And no doubt it's a longer history for you before I connect to the internet. So what internet trends of development have surprised you the most since those days?
Yeah, start with many items, but then especially the wireless Wi-Fi and the mobile. Mm-hmm. So wireless communication to be the primary link of the internet, which was not expected. We can theoretically can of course passing on any media, but then the wireless media was so successful and with a lot of efforts, by the way, though. For the mobile and especially for the Wi-Fi. Mm-hmm. And the second one is audio video streams on the top of the internet, because the internet was designed for the retransmission when the kind of something happened. Therefore, it was known that it's not designed for the stream media type of transmission, but it was successfully achieved because of the basically with a lot of bandwidth to accommodate with the failure of a packet and also the CDN type of buffering technology, which was so sophisticated. So it's now very much amazing result. Even we didn't expect that much.
So in the early days, you mentioned that people did not anticipate that wireless, especially Wi-Fi, would take off. What was the ongoing imagination at that time? Was it that people would just keep connecting more and more with Ethernet or with some other kind of technology?
That's a very much, the today's mobile means. Moving with a human being, and of course, moving with their automobile, and we started the researches on and kind of putting all the internet equipment on a automobile, especially provided from the leading automobile companies, and then which was very much fun, but with a geolocational satellite. Things and so, which was very expensive, by the way, on the beginning of the 90s. So that was very much interesting, that tracking the people and then understanding. And so it's very much imagination about AI and, kind of data world by doing that. But it's all happened because of the wireless technology and the spectrum lead. And then also the Wi-Fi was a very interesting topics all over the world, because it was a short range 2.54 gigahertz spectrum. Mm-hmm. So it was supposed to be locally managed. Mm-hmm. But now, because of the market on the internet expanded globally, therefore the adjusting with international collaboration toward the global internet happened on the, various places, including IT. So, which was very much a historical change, introducing Wi-Fi globally by the efforts of national spectrum regulation authorizations. So that was big change.
Excellent. And of course, it changed the human life a lot. I still remember when I first had a successful video conference on a very quickly moving Taiwan high-speed rails. It really felt like magic. How would you assess the breakthrough of wireless communication on our daily life, both ethically speaking and also socially speaking? Have the human condition changed because of the wireless communications?
Yeah, that's a very interesting thing. And probably you have the same issue about kind of privacy. But early 90s automobile with a camera, sensors, and then moving around, connected on the internet, which was a very, very beginning of the kind of research activities on the mobile internet. But then suddenly the people noticed that camera on the testing car, and then they started to talk about the privacy. Mm-hmm. So I did a big lecture in Europe, and then the automobile and the sensing around, which is a very interesting subject. And then everybody was so happy at the conference when I did the keynote introducing that kind of activities. But then I asked any question, and then one of the person raised the hand, and that was a great idea, but I don't want my car's location to be known by my wife. That was the question. That was a kind of wake up on a privacy issue with a wireless and the mobility type of a thing. And we started to work in the very intensively on that kind of a security privacy issues since then.
Yeah, because in the early 90s, even the web layer, as you mentioned, the web browser to websites, it's not encrypted by default. So not just someone's wife, but all the Wi-Fi provider and anyone really knows everything that you typed into websites, and people were okay with it, I guess. It was the norm back then. And then people suddenly discover, oh no, somebody else is actually getting all those data and pushing advertisements or state surveillance on things. Mm. So that's why we switched to let's encrypt and many end-to-end encryption standards. So I think that's really one of the kind of major differences between this decade and the decades around 90s and early 2000s.
That's exactly, I agree. Yeah,
but you actually, way before we were discussing this, I've read that you've said that Japan is a pioneer in the ethical use of the internet, which is fascinating. So would you like to elaborate a little bit more, in addition to the privacy preserving and to encryption and so on, the kind of higher level view on ethical use of the internet?
Yeah, actually, I'd like to raise the same question to you, but the recognition about the internet mm-hmm. to the general public started from 1995 January, which was an earthquake on the Hanshin area, the Osaka area, mm-hmm. and so that time internet was not known because it's late 1995 was Windows 95, which
yeah.
is the name of bundled TCP/IP.
Yes.
So before that, January 95 was a big earthquake, and then everyone noticed that the internet is a different communication than different media than the normal broadcasting media and the newspaper and the other things. So what is the internet? So that was a wake up impact by the earthquake, and after the smartphone, in the 2007, and then the 2011 big earthquake is waking up that the importance of geolocation things and the tracking of the people and the finding out your family's safetiness and other things, and the lifeline type of impact was very much known in Japan. So every time we have an earthquake-based disaster and other natural disasters, then the people working together, helping each other, utilizing the internet and the smartphone and those devices. So that way, the very much overlapping concept about the helping the people's life, helping each other, helping family with the internet, and the importance of the internet, role of the internet, merging together because of that reason, I believe.
Okay.
So this is one of the very important aspects there. But in that sense, we are sharing of that kind of,
have
a
earthquake and typhoon too, right? Yes.
And a natural disaster as well. So disaster recovery might be the very important issue to share other researches between the Taiwan and the Japan, because it's not a single scientific solution can solve that kind of issue. So it's, of course, a mixture of science and the communities and the communications and government regulation and other things. So it's a very much a complex issue, but we are both very much serious on those things. So I think, you know, for the future, they will never leave us. So we should work together.
Definitely. We've already looked at how internet was designed with resilience in mind. And indeed, I think one of the most important quality in a disaster recovery sense is that it's permissionless or end-to-end innovation, right? Because if you're using a large broadcasting or whatever other pre-internet technology, you have to convince the operator that something is worth doing before the operator actually adds that functionality. Mm. But on the internet, as long as two people agree on a protocol, maybe one in Taiwan, one in Japan, then we can actually begin that permissionless innovation without our internet service providers agreeing or not agree with whatever we're doing. And this may be the most important quality in my experience during a disaster, because people closest to the pain knows how to innovate to resolve that pain, so to speak.
Yeah, that's a very interesting and important discussion. The end-to-end policy, you know, can mean a lot of things, including the motor, the distributed autonomous action for the complicated issues, working together in many ways. So I've been, you know, working recently on a, you know, kind of a medical and the health application. Mm-hmm. In a very much advanced way, with a, you know, kind of a surgery robot and other things, and they care about the latency, which is a little bit of different things, but they also are very sensitive about the, you know, kind of accuracy, low latency, and privacy as well. So very strong requirements happening, but it's also, you know, very much a real-time manner. So I was thinking about the latency of, you know, I've been working with a medical doctor, and they are talking about, you know, kind of 100 milliseconds latency and a little bit more, little less type of things when they are working on a surgery robot, right? Mm-hmm. And then, so think about the distance. Latency between the Taiwan and the Japan.
The speed of light matters.
Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. And so we can share that kind of a very much a real-time sensitive technology to be developed. It's if that is you know, kind of more than 200 milliseconds, then some area of a technology doesn't work. So this is a very important area to work together as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And for our audience, what Murai-san means is that if I say something and then I have to wait more than one of the fifth of a second to see Murai-san nodding, then I will not feel that we're in the same room. But if the latency is low, that is to say the time it takes from Murai-san saying something and me nodding and he sees me nodding is low, then even though we're actually quite apart, we feel that we're in the same room. So it's very important for the kind of co-presence connectivity. I totally agree. One of the things about a web ecosystem that I often think about is that we first have a really good publishing platform, and especially the real-time streaming of first audio and then video, as you mentioned. But a very mature payment systems, especially international payment system, came much later. So between the time that web or web 2.0 happened and that we have a really good micropayment that's reliable, there's easily a decade or more of window in which really one of the only ways to fund a large website is advertisement. But you've also stated that the advertising ecosystem on the internet is broken. And how is it broken for you?
Yeah, that is very much, you know, kind of in the middle of the issue, right? And so the very much of, you know, kind of target marketing was a key for the business. Business.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Business on the internet. And so I remember the, you know, the Yahoo Jerry and those people started to watch our Olympic mm-hmm. website, and yep. then they found out finally that the advertisement is going to be a key and the target marketing is going to be a key. And therefore, it's probably past 20 years of internet business largely depend on a very effective way of target marketing. And therefore, of course, advertisement is going to be dynamically allocated. So a real-time bidding and those technology. So it was good that in the past 20 years, of the growing economy and other things. But now it's a time, I believe, that thinking about a different way that good content's going to be sponsored by a good advertisement. Advertisement in a paper newspaper, the newspaper, paper-based newspaper time, then advertisement was targeted on the good content, mm-hmm. right? And mm-hmm. so as the TV program as well. But the sophisticated, the interleaved layers for the advertisement business, and then the sponsor could not recognize that what's going to be a content for the kind of advertisement mm-hmm. they put. That was happening also on the TV, but very much on the internet. Mm-hmm. And the internet is taking all the advertisement business from the other media. Mm-hmm. So this is very much a strong responsibility for us that the proper sponsorship is going to be kind of sponsoring the good contents. Otherwise, the musicians, artists, and the good journalism would not be growing up. But our young people cannot work on that, and that's going to be a very bad future. So I think it's time to redesign the advertisement area mm-hmm. and with a kind of more toward understanding, trust, transparency, and the openness.
Okay, so let me check my understanding. What you're saying is essentially, say on a search page, I type a keyword and I see some advertisement and I click on one of the links from the search result and I see more advertisement because the website is funding itself through such advertisements. And what you're saying is that first, the advertisers doesn't really know which websites the advertisement is going to, and even more, the kind of websites, kind of content that builds addiction or that is, frankly speaking, just recycling and not in an upcycling way, other people's quality content just built for engagement and more addiction tend to draw more advertisement money. And so the advertiser can't even kind of opt out of this kind of thing. And then we see more and more content that is lower quality surface to the top because they get more funding and therefore can spend more time on search engine optimization and so mm-hmm. on. Did I get your idea correctly?
Basically, the when you get the kind of a result out from the search or the getting the news article, mm-hmm. and so the important thing is that who's the originator of the information mm-hmm. type of the information could be recognized instantly and easier mm-hmm. with the open manner. So, mm-hmm. Which is, so we call it originator profile, but this content is created by this organization, this newspaper company, this journalism media or whatever. Then if the you got that information, and if you are easily find out who's the responsible person on this content is, then you can. It's up to you that you trust, you like, that originator, mm-hmm. but sometimes you can't reach that kind of information. Mm-hmm. So we're just adding that kind of architecture and data structure might help. So this type of a discussion happened quite recently with the people like the Reporters Without Border, mm-hmm. the collection of journalism. Journalists are working together, but then it's really important that I see that the technology experts are very much small number to involve those kind of discussion these days. So I mean, not biased by a business, not biased too much by the policy, you know, but the technology people should be involved for the, you know, kind of designing that kind of a future, which is very important. But the good news is that there is a lot of discussion toward that kind of the information architecture to be trusted more in the how we can do without. So you mentioned about end-to-end trust type of things. And so how can we trust, and what is the relationship with the freedom of information flow and, you know, that kind of
anyone
thing.
Can claim to be a journalist. But whether they're reputable or not, that's another thing that most people cannot easily find out. I mean, it's very easy for them now to start crowdfunding and do collection of small payments and so on. Finally, a payment layer is more or less there. But then we don't have an equal reputation layer, is what you're saying, essentially.
Right. So you were interested in a payment, and you repeatedly use the payment things. And so... that's a very interesting subject for the future, I believe. And then, you know, so the micropayment, especially, and the community currency type of things, and the autonomous manner is going to change a lot. That has been discussed also from the early 90s on the internet area, but at that time, only, you know, year 2000, for example, is only 6% of the human beings were on the internet. Now it's almost everybody. So this change on the population of the internet access turned out to be kind of a motor, the ideal payment discussion and the micropayment type of activities is getting very much real. Now, because everybody now starting the internet, so the payment on the internet could be means a lot in many ways.
That's excellent. Yeah. So it seems like after we've decentralized publishing and journalism and so on, we need to rebuild the kind of norms that the journalists and academics and so on that already exists in the textual world now to the data world, so that the same kind of reputations can be honored. And I think this is very interesting because you've seen many people in many different jurisdictions talking about how to solve this reputation problem. On one end, you can do a forced real name registration for everybody logging into the internet and assign, I don't know, social credits all their actions. That's certainly a over-centralizing kind of solution. On the other hand, you've seen jurisdictions saying Bitcoin is now also recognized as money within our jurisdiction, which is maybe the other end of things, right? And you were a member of the Internet Society, and no doubt that the multi-stakeholder panels talk about these different philosophies all the time. So what's your take on the current century, the current decade of those very different governing philosophies and their influence on the kind of multi-stakeholder standard making when it comes to the reputation layer management you just mentioned?
So it's really important that, we should, all of us should recognize properly about the kind of architectural construction of the internet space, right? Mm-hmm. So people sometimes confuse that the internet is all the messages on the top of it. And then also some people say the internet is just the IP, and the digital information is going to be the exchanged properly around the globe. So that's in a sense true, that when we are talking about the internet governance, for example, right? Mm-hmm. And then are we talking about the internet as a kind of digital data to reach from a point A to point B, which is a very much a core internet? And then probably everybody should understand that benefit. And then when we are talking these days about the, you know, kind of what is a core internet.
Mm-hmm.
And now, because it's internet is a lifeline to most of the people, and therefore, it's like oxygen, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
if we stop the internet, and mm-hmm. then you know, we're gonna be choking, and then we're gonna mm-hmm. die. And that's a basic laws of core internet. And for the application area, and we can share whatever we want to share as a platform, so that the video transmission and the encryption mechanism in a general way. And then maybe some part of the payment infrastructure is going to be that kind of a basic common
mm-hmm.
Platform to be standardized. Mm-hmm. But also we can accommodate anyone and overlaying on top of it. So conflicting each other in the different ideas, different culture, then it can create the overlaying architecture for testing, and for the happiness of those people who are utilizing that kind of overlay services. So, since that is on top of the common platform, then once it was recognized that it's a much very good things for the more people to be involved, then that can extend that kind of overlaid services, which is a very scary rough architecture of the different layers. So a basic TCP/IP layer, web layer, and mm-hmm. Also the application layer.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think this is the great thing about the early internet pioneers is the kind of humility, right, in the design, the humility, because I keep hearing you saying that, the application layer people, the people in the future, the people who want to build new things should be given the room, should be given the canvas, instead of the lower layers being like perfect designers, designing everything to perfection. We should be open about the new possibility of newer generations doing new kind of application layers, reusing our work, but not constrained by our work. I think this is really, really important and distinguishes internet from pretty much all the other centralizing technologies that came before it.
That's very much true. So the development for the future targeted on more to the diversity of the requirements, which is really the important things. But what do you think about the autonomous versus you are sitting on a middle of kind of government mm-hmm. structure, right?
Yes.
As well, in the you understand very much of the autonomous distributed system nature of the internet.
Mm-hmm.
So how can you balance those two space?
Yeah. I think a lot of it comes down to whether the internet, the decentralization, can provide the same guarantees of low-risk service delivery that people previously thought only hierarchical services can deliver. Because it literally takes a leap of faith for people to believe that random operators that I have not met will be able to deliver your real-time video and recover from it. As I mentioned, especially when we're on high-speed rails, that's like magic. So for many people, I believe it really takes a initial exposure to some sort of decentralized service, and for them to say, oh, so it doesn't actually go through anything, but it still works. And then from there, we now have the shared experience that people can go to. I understand, for example, that both Japan and Taiwan used a Bluetooth-based technology. In Japan, I believe it's Kokokoa, and in Taiwan, the Taiwan social distancing application. Nowadays, I think more than half of our population are using Bluetooth Bluetooth-based contact tracing. And it's this kind of leap of faith, because people would ask, so who will stay those data and how long will it stay? And we're like, no, it's in each other's phones and not in anywhere else. And for people who trust their own phones, I think this is easier to make this leap of faith. But for people who trust more about the centralizing state-based apparatus, then people would ask, what if I lose my phone? What if my phone turns off Bluetooth? Is there a way to more forcefully record the contact tracing and things like that? And I think it takes really a few weeks of real exposure to exposure notification for people to begin to understand, oh, this actually works as well, even though that it's not stored in one single place.
Yeah, that's very much, I respect the other, the application contact tracing, and especially on the COVID era, and which was very much learned by, kind of Japanese people, Japanese business, Japanese authority for that kind of great deployment of the application. So, yeah, thank you very much for that kind of lesson learned from you and your country. We did, a very good learning from the what you have achieved.
Yeah, and I think the open standard and open source spirit of Japan, because we learned a lot from the Japanese Bluetooth exposure notification, because we roll out earlier, I believe. And then we learned from that. And then, of course, also worked together on GitHub and many other collaborative platforms. So kudos all around. And now we're back to talk about what is the future of the internet hold. Murai-san talked about connecting first all the computers in the world, and then everyone, all the human beings on the planet Earth and maybe other planets, and later on connecting them even when they're moving very quickly, even on high-speed rails or cars, through wireless technology. So Murai-san, what other things are you connecting nowadays through the internet?
That's a very interesting way of kind of raising a question. But we are running the internet battery society. It is a kind of subject of research and the university class as well. So we are assuming that all the batteries, I mean, the battery is going to be, of course, very much in advance. And then the large battery with a very safe battery stored in every single building, and of course, the e-vehicle, and of course, in our computers, handset, and the other things, and smartphone. And so small one to big one, but it's all batteries, and the digital technology only could be supported by the proper energy management. And so if those batteries going to be connected, assuming that the internet everywhere in any mobile network, and then optimizing to move around the contained energy of the battery could be kind of a super optimized, then what's going to be the future? And it's certainly necessary for the digital technology society. So this is including the micromanagement, micropayment, and then also the optimization of the large space, of course, the environment things, and the battery technology itself, of course, the networking and the passing the energy, wireless maybe. And this includes a lot of issues, but viewing the society and also the understanding the importance of that area, it's going to be very interesting to connect that battery.
Okay, so just to make sure that our audience understand the impact of this technology, say I have this tablet here and I connect it to my laptop. Currently, I can only connect it through a USB-C line, but it does something smart. And if I'm going to run out of battery here and that place still have plenty of battery, then it charges this way. But if it's the other way around and my computer is running out of battery, then it charges charges back. And so that's one sort of management, but it only works on two devices connect through a line. And Murai-san, are you talking about really just connecting anything to anything? And then you would just figure out the most effective way to use electricity nearby instead of just through the central power grid.
Yeah, that's exactly. And we are talking about the large scale, a very large battery on hospitals, schools, and all the buildings. And also, by nature, by e-vehicle, it's recognized that the very great power for the vehicle is, with the advanced technology it's provided. So it's everywhere. I mean, batteries, quality battery is going to be everywhere very, very soon. But the only lacking portion is it's not networked, managed, and then because of the various reasons, but the standardization and also the important is a payment scheme.
Yes. I've witnessed that people's interested in decentralized power grid, including, as you mentioned, on EVs like Gogoro or Tesla and so on, really skyrocketed after the Ukraine situation, right? Because after the Russian invasion to Ukraine, people discover, you can actually power the, Starlink and other connectivity devices with this kind of disconnected to the main power grid, but still self-charging during the day using solar panels and so on. So I believe there's a strong interest in Taiwan in both the investor space, but also for just regular people who want to remain connected during a natural or unnatural disaster.
Yeah, so maybe you knew that, in the Japan's regulation, then all the mobile tower, mm-hmm. mobile, the yeah. antenna tower
mm-hmm. yes.
in a rural has to had 3 hours of UPS mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. by mandatory mm-hmm. in before 2011. Mm-hmm. And then 2011 earthquake happened, and then they noticed that importance because 3 hours of time, all the mobile device has been connected for at least for two, three hours, even area of a tsunami area.
I see.
And in Fukushima. So the Japan decided to have a kind of specific city and a congested area to be 24 hours of a battery life. So it's a kind of mandatory for the mobile carrier to accommodate that 24 hours of a battery life and always charged for in the then. So that's going to be an infrastructure of the only by the batteries, right? And of course, talking with other electric power sources. But it's not far. I mean, it's not the kind of well optimized at this point. But it's going to be very important infrastructure for the people. And then, as you mentioned, it's true that the Ukraine situation stay connected on the internet only could be provided by the proper energy grid.
Yeah, I think the other thing they did is to allow free roaming from any telecommunication carrier's phone to any telecommunication carrier's tower, integrating the core networks, which was, again, something that we've talked in abstract before on the standard-making groups, but it's amazing to see it in actual action.
Yeah, the other thing is that the drone flying mm-hmm. and then the finding of that the kind of power to the public reached and that they can charge by themselves and then the flying more mm-hmm. By mm-hmm. the drone. So a drone can be more to the autonomous device and finding out the battery charging point and then then leaving by automatically. And by the way, the other things I wanted to ask you was mm-hmm. that because Taiwan is a super, super advanced device nation states, I mean, providing all the necessary devices, and those mm-hmm. Devices turned out to be connected now, right?
Yes.
And on the internet. And I've been, the other area of, I've been involved is a medical device mm-hmm. and not networked yet. And very well, and standardized yet. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's very important. I've been working with the surgery room of the hospital and the different devices staying in inside the room. But the standardization have been provided by the area of a doctor, medical doctor, behind.
Yes.
And therefore, very much a silo. They are not exchanging the data and, you know, that kind of design that way yet. I was thinking about the, you know, kind of about those area, how the, you know, the Taiwan impacts, you think, about the medical device to be connected, because the battery has not been connected, medical device has not been connected. Well, those are the two major area I was thinking that they should be connected. And then you know, certainly the Taiwan should be contributing for the future of those areas.
Definitely, yeah. In the past few years, thanks to a proposal from the presidential hackathon, we've been working on connecting the diagnostic equipments on ambulances in real time to the kind of major trauma handling hospitals and so on. And it's conceivable that this connection through fire and other data standards can be then extended to even prevent the traffic accidents and so on, because it provides the real-time input on the safety of the roads and so on. So I totally agree that connecting toward shared safety, that is a very important mission. But you said two things that should be connected, and I want to ask you this. So how do you think about, I don't know, Neuralink or connecting brains to other brains? Is that going too far? Can we expect something resembling the Matrix, and would you choose the blue or red pills on connecting directly brains to one another?
Yeah, so I think it's very much, you know, the very first lecture in public is that about the internet was that the question was how the, you know, the computers, human, and what is the connecting things after that. So I said the brains, and brain is a very very much a digital signal based organism, and then, you know, so it's a human being, wisdom, knowledge to be connected. That's the purpose of the internet. And then if that is the case, then it's very important for the, you know, kind of having a vision that the connecting brains over the internet, which is not like the physically connecting as a device being a brain, but it's also the human's emotion, sense, and those things to be connected. So, which is very much like the Matrix, I believe, but it's more toward the optimistic to me, that you know, kind of, taking a red pill and creating the bright future. So that's basically what I've been thinking about.
That's interesting, very interesting to hear. I would like to ask, so what about privacy and security? Because as we are connecting, as you mentioned, more and more of our nonverbal expressions, more and more of our real-time emotions, and especially with a low latency, then there is a real chance that some device on the internet, maybe sponsored by an advertiser, can actually predict our thought patterns, especially our emotions. That is basically rendering privacy obsolete, because there's nothing to hide if you can predict down to that level. For example, Yuval Harari has been talking about the danger of that over-predicting and even manipulating advertisement-fueled engine. Would you share your thoughts about, did you worry about that? Do you think there's ways around that? How to make it a safer space?
Well, actually, I'm very much a, you know, optimistic person, as you know. But it's always you know, kind of important that working together with a transparent manner. It's not the black box, the technology, so that you know, if anything wrong happened, then you know, we have the ability to fix that together, especially. So a diversity of participants and the ideas. working together is going to be very important because of checking from the various direction mm-hmm. and the, for the, you know, kind of what's happening and the monitoring that. But it's really important that the moving forward by, you know, kind of transparent checking mechanism, which is basically the role of research and education, though.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
The internet started as a kind of a broad connection among the, you know, kind of research entity in the various areas. I mean, starting, of course, from the hard science researchers, because they are consuming a lot of data and traffic. But now it's any kind of researchers could be participating on a, in a kind of same board. Otherwise, it's very difficult to solve the complicated issue of the human being and the planet. So now the probably revisiting on a, you know, kind of a broad and the proper research and educational network around the world, having a very important role for the researchers in the education and the next generation of the people, which is very much, you know, kind of we should work together for that kind of a future human being, human resources, as well as the research result.
Okay, so basically, if sufficient amount of people find this worrying, then paradoxically, it's not that worrying at all, because then people closest to the situation will figure out in a transparent way to publish their findings rather than perish. So I think this is a very, very nice view into the culture that is internet multi-stakeholderism. Basically, if you worry about something, then invite people who worry about the same thing into the community. This is a really good philosophy.
Exactly. I believe in you know, human being creativity and also the kind of ethical minds for everyone.
Excellent. So my final question, as an innovative pioneer who once suggested make good friends and do what makes you happy, as a general advice, do you have any specific advice for our younger generations who are born with internet connectivity?
It's a very interesting that, you know, thinking about the, you know, the issues in front of you, but also very important is thinking about the human being and the planet. So thinking about the planet more. So this is very important, I believe. The young people tend to be, you know, kind of excited on, you know, all the issues in front, which is very good, but very natural. But also the always don't forget about the planet we are living on. And then, you know, so looking, I remember the, you know, my friend, the Mamoru Mori-san, who's a kind of a twice traveler on a space, from, you know, Japanese point of view, who's been, you know, serving at the science museum director. The Mori-san was, you know, the second trip on a space shuttle was monitoring the planet with a, you know, kind of high vision video coder at that time. And then, you know, so observing the planet and from the space. And the daytime with the sunshine, then, you know, planet is thinking about, you know, kind of mountains, ocean, and, you know, so they're very much a kind of a natural environment type of view. But at night, he saw the, all the lights in the cities connecting by the train or the highway, and he felt that technology is also an environment of the planet. And so this is a contribution from the technological approach for the planet future. And so this is a very much a very strong encouragement from I received from him. And so my suggestion to the young people is that thinking about the planet and then your roles and the contribution is going to be for the future is going to be, you know, very much a kind of your role for the participating for creating the future.
Excellent. Yeah, the internet is like a brain the size of the planet, and connecting to the brain is the most important thing. Connecting to the brain also reminds us to think about the people and the planet instead of just the projects or problems before us. Thank you again for your thoughtful and inspiring sharing answers. And please check more information for our audience and videos on TaiwanPlus.com. We have a YouTube channel, and if you like today's episode, be sure to subscribe and share. Thank you again, Murai-san, and see you next time. Live long and prosper.